Hi, welcome to IT Edits episode 77, Virtualization in a Nutshell Part 2. My name's Nikki Curtis, and we have
Sue Fay
and
Mark
from the same episode. You're Mark from the same episode from this one and the last one. And so we're going to take a look at the second part of virtualization. The idea was originally to do it as one episode, but we chatted too much.
I think we were talking a bit too much.
Though. I think so, but I think it was all good stuff. So we thought we'd split that up, and this is the second part. So the second part, the first part we looked at network virtualization, so VLANs, stuff like that. We looked at storage virtualization, SANs. We looked at server virtualization, Hyper-V, VMware, and Citrix, and we pretty much left it there. So, what's left in the virtualization arena? So there's lots of things left. The first thing I'm going to go across is application compatibility, and I'm confused as to why that slide is there, I've got to admit. And if we have a look at some challenges of applications, typically when you're running them, is I don't know, if you're running an application on your machine, you need to make sure that application in no way is going to conflict with any other application running. Now, most of the time, you and me probably wouldn't bother doing that. If you're on your home machine, you just run Microsoft Word and you take it as granted that PowerPoint's not going to conflict with Word, etc. But out there, when you're running multiple applications, often written by lots of third-party vendors, this can become problematic. You know, one application you install could potentially break another application, particularly if, well, the key example I always go through is applications running that require different versions of Java runtime. So we've got application A that requires Java runtime version 1. We've got application B, we install it, but it requires Java runtime version 2. And that overwrites version 1, which breaks application A or 1, or you know what I'm trying to say anyway. So application compatibility, what we could do is, what could we do?
Virtualizing.
Well, there's a surprise, isn't it? So yeah, so in a virtualization presentation, yep, you guessed that one right. So we could virtualize this one. So the solution is something called application virtualization. Now, I'm just going to have a quick peek on the next slide before I go forward, and I'm making a bit of a hash up of this one now. But the first thing I'm going to go across is Microsoft's application virtualization offering, which is called AppV. Now, some of you guys might know it as SoftGrid, Softricity. It was basically a company which Microsoft bought or acquired, whatever you want to call it.
So put the V at the end.
So put the bought it and put the V at the end of it. Yeah. So it's really interesting the way application compatibility works. A lot of the time, what I deal with is desktop standardization, and typically when you look at desktop standardization and conflict analysis, you use something like Wise Package Studio, and it's quite a lengthy process, and you're taking
it's been around
about
a long while, haven't they? It's kind of
absolutely packages. It's been around for ages. Yeah. You know, starting off with SysDiff. I don't know if you remember SysDiff.
Right.
Remember
SysDiff? Yes, yeah. Yes.
All that stuff. So yeah, it's been around for ages, and there's loads of people skilled with that. But the thing is, it is a skilled thing to be able to do. It's not the kind of thing that I could do on the side. Normally, your application packages, that's all they do. So the complexity of application packaging is a problem when you're looking at dealing with standardized desktops. And then one thing about application virtualization is because the applications are running in a virtualized bubble, those applications don't get to see all the other applications running. So because they don't get to see those applications running, they're never going to conflict. So
does that give any other issues though, if you're trying to move stuff between applications?
Absolutely. Okay, so
there's sort of pros and cons then.
There are some pros and cons on that. So conflict analysis, that's a great winner on that one. But yeah, they're running their own bubble. What I said is they can't communicate between those bubbles. They don't even know if the other application's running. But say if you wanted to do a mail merge between them, let's say you had an Access database and you wanted to generate a mail merge, or you want to mail merge into Word, well, that wouldn't be possible. Okay, not if they're running their own bubbles. Now, you've got a solution
for
this.
This is a bit like when we've been talking about virtualizations on the server. So we've been talking about virtualization of a Hyper-V and VMware. We've got different operating systems that all sit on their own and they're oblivious to anything else.
Yep.
This is taking it to the next level then, really,
absolutely,
isn't it? So
yeah.
You still have an operating system actually effectively being its own bubble and can't see any other operating system or whatever. This is taking it down to the next level where the applications are now basically exactly the same concept of a server OS, but at the application level,
absolutely, yeah.
They can't see one another, or maybe there's something like the clustered shared volume where they can share something as well.
They can, absolutely. So yeah, with that solution
concept
we're talking about, with it's exactly the same concept. Yeah, so what we're talking about with the example of mail merging between Access and Word. Now, if you wanted to do that mail merge, well, you've got a couple of choices. One thing you could do is you could virtualize them all into the same bubble. So you could virtualize the entire of Office into the same bubble, and you could argue that, you know what, they're probably not going to do any conflict they're not in conflict with one another, and that could be argued to be pretty safe. In actual fact, with Office, because so many applications tie into Office, so you have like your email archiving, they tie into it. This is often one application which is actually installed properly. Doesn't give virtualization justice, does it, to describe it as that?
For Office?
Yeah, things like Office.
What about all my different versions of Office? So say I've got Office 2010, which it's about to be released, but I actually still wanted to keep Office 2007. Could I do that?
In that example, you could. So what you could do is you could be running Office 2007, and you might want to try out Office 2010, or maybe just Outlook 2010 for Exchange. So you could virtualize Outlook 2010 and deploy that out. And when that Outlook 2010 is running, it's got no idea that the rest of the Office suite's running. So it could be a good way of testing. So with application virtualization, with so many advantages so far, it's easier to repackage them. You actually call it resequencing them. It's just a way of getting it into an app V format, if you like. No conflict analysis on that one. Okay.
No conflict analysis because there's no need, or?
There's absolutely no need to. There's okay. No need to, because they just can't see it. Now, with that example, the Melmote example, there is another solution. You can, if you like, I'm going to describe it as a bridge. It's not the real word, but you probably know what I mean. You know, it's just like a little connector between the bubbles, so you can connect them all up. Or you can put them in the same bubble. It's up to you.
Okay.
So that's looking at application virtualization. Now, the nice thing about application virtualization is if all your apps are running in a virtualization bubble, just think how nice and clean that's keeping your OS. Okay, you're not tattooing that OS. It's, you know, it's keeping nice and standard, so it's a standardized operating environment. So
I'm thinking of things like Java here.
Exactly.
10,000 editions and versions of Java over the years, and everybody wants this one, that one, and optimize for this, that. Actually, you get lots of Java bubbles.
Absolutely. I mean, our most successful customer that we've implemented application virtualization for is definitely the NHS, no doubt about it. They run lots of applications, lots of them, you know, written by different vendors, and a lot of them requiring different versions of Java runtime. And it was a nightmare for them to deal with all these different versions. You know, they install the next application, it breaks four others, and all of these are in their own little bubble. So each application can be placed in its own bubble with the required version of Java runtime. And that's really
so
cool.
When you have a bubble kind of deployed to your, let's say, this laptop, so you can have a local file, double-click on, let's say, a Word document, and it'll open in that application.
Absolutely.
So what if you have several... let's say the 2010 edition in one bubble, 2007 edition in one bubble, double click on it, how does it know where to go?
It would just be down to your file associations.
Right, so it'll appear in your My Programs as normal?
Yeah, it will do, yeah. It's a good question to come on to as well, because application virtualization, it does work with file associations. So the fact that you've got, let's say, Visio installed on this, or, you know, rolled out to this machine in an app V bubble, something does get passed down to the OS, the file associations does get passed down. So if you run up a VSD file or whatever Visio is, it will fire that up.
Can you have a local copy installed and then run a bubble as well? Let's say I have Office installed, but I'm on the network and, you know, automatically deployed it.
If you want to, yeah, I can't think of any particular good reason for that.
So what is the component then that you're installing on the desktop then? It must be an add-on.
Yeah, there is a client side. There's an AppV client which you need to push out to them. So yeah, there's AppV client you push out to them, and generally the way it works is, and this is another nice thing about application virtualization, is it allows us for the first time really to target user accounts. Now, when you look at System Center and products like that, you're often targeting systems, computers. So I'm targeting this machine here. This machine's always going to have, what application do you use that no one else uses? Photoshop. So let's say Sufei uses Photoshop. So this machine here that Sufei uses always got Photoshop. Now when she moves to my machine, there's no Photoshop on it. With AppV, we can do user-based targeting.
Is that natively in AppV? Because I remember this going back a couple of years when it was still SoftGrid. I actually wrote an app for Dave, because Dave does SoftGrid, AppV, all that. That kind of, you can subscribe, as a user, you can subscribe to an AD group. And so based on AD groups, you get deployed.
Absolutely, yeah.
So it's AppV that tells the machine, I guess, that this user is in this group. And
absolutely, yeah. The nice thing about AppV as well, what you're talking about is the deployment of AppV applications. It's not only a way to run applications, but it's also a deployment mechanism. So when I've resequenced my application, let's say QuickTime or Photoshop, I said earlier, when I've resequenced that, obviously I need to roll that out to your machines. Now I can just do a standard MSI install, That's no problem. And what will actually happen is it pulls the content of that application down into the local cache of the machine. You won't see it in program files, Photoshop, you won't see it there, it's just in the local cache of that machine.
Right.
When you run it, it pulls it from the local cache of it. Now, the other way of doing it, and this is the way we generally do it within I'm not going to say the company, but this is where we generally find it very successful, is deploy via IIS. So we stream it down during logon. So when the user logs on for the first time, it finds out what groups they're a member of. The SoftGrid client then queries the SoftGrid, there's a SoftGrid database to say, right, you have app A, app B, and app C. It builds the shortcuts on the desktop, and when they click it for the first time, it streams that application down over, you know, port 80.
So what's that back-end server architecture? Is that an app B server part, or does it actually fit in with, say, system center products?
It doesn't fit in so much with that system center and AppV. There's not that much tie-in with them at the moment. Now, again, Microsoft would hit me for saying that because they say, R2, it's got AppV. All you can do with R2, there's a little tick box that says, yeah, AppV deployment, and it deploys the cache down to a local machine. So what I could do with system center is I could get the cache preloaded in all the machines.
Okay.
That's one thing
but
I could do.
But there is an AppV server component that sits on a server.
Yeah, there's basically a little database.
I'm sure at some point that's going to be into the system center product. The type of V's part.
It's going to be, yeah. It's got to be.
Hyper app V.
So say I log on.
Yep.
And I don't have Office, and you're trying to push Office to me. How long will it take before I can use this Office?
So it's a good job this is a double part episode, that's all I can say.
well, we'll make an advantage of it. Now you split it into two episodes, we've got lots of questions we can ask.
Exactly. So we need to look at the sequencing. It's a good question, because when I log on, when Sufei logs on, she wants to run Photoshop for the first time, clicks on it, how long is she going to have to wait? And let's say the Photoshop package is arbitrarily a gigabyte. It's probably not that big, but let's say it's a gig.
It's more than that, surely.
I don't know, with the clip art. So it's a gig in my world. Okay, so it's a gig, and when she clicks on it the first time, well, obviously if the cache is local, if I use System Center, she can stream from, and it does do that, it streams from the local cache. Okay, or we can stream it from a web server. Now, the nice thing about when you're resequencing these applications, the way resequencing works is, obviously, AppV needs to understand what changes that application install is going to make. So it looks at the machine prior to the installation, and it looks at the machine after the installation. Very similar to SysDiff. So it's just like before and after snapshots. Now, you can go in and tinker with it and look at what registry changes and what other things it's picked up. So, and then it can repackage it, says, right, that registry changes, these are the files that have changed. And then what it does, it will watch you run it for the first time, and it's particularly interested in what files and what blocks you're pulling across from the cache.
It will watch me.
It will do.
A bit violated.
It will do. Or it will watch the person resequencing, anyway. Okay, so it watches them and says, okay, in order to load up Photoshop, then I'm going to need access to these, and it prioritises the streaming of those down to the client. So you could have the Photoshop welcome to window while the rest of it's streaming to you.
Right.
It's like the old NT4 logon box, wasn't it? It used to pop up really quickly.
Yeah.
The server was loaded. While you're trying to do control delete, it's still in the background so trying to load up.
These bubbles then, are they OS specific? So let's say you've got two users.
Mm-hmm.
He's running XP, I'm running Windows 7. And we both want the same version of Photoshop. Do you have to then deploy two separate bubbles, or?
To be honest, you would have to check on an application per application basis, because you need to understand how the application is interfacing with the registry. If it's a simple app, very probably it would work.
Right.
Okay, very probably.
Mm. Sounds very interesting.
Yeah, so that's AppV. So the great thing about AppV, no conflict analysis, it's easier to repackage, and I can now target a user. So Sufei logs onto my machine because their machine's broken. I get, Photoshop streams down into your session, if you like. And when I log on it, I don't get to see it. It hasn't climbed up.
Maybe for a future episode, then we could demo some of this.
Definitely,
multiple applications or the rest, because I'd be interested to see it.
I'd be interested.
Absolutely.
A lot of people watching this actually haven't seen that and probably understand what we're talking about, but to see it must be quite good.
It is really amazing to see. And once you see the concept of it and just really the understanding that there's no conflicts and it's keeping that desktop nice and tidy. Mm. How many times have you guys reinstalled your machines because you've installed too many apps and uninstalled them?
And your machine's
grinds to a halt. Well, that's not going to happen with this. You know, so that's a huge advantage.
Cost-wise, just out of curiosity?
Cost-wise, this is a bit of a strange one. With AppV, there's various different ways you can run AppV. Now, I've been talking about running AppV on a client machine, so just your standard fat client, and you're running AppV onto it. Now, you actually need to be be part of something called MDOPS for that. Microsoft, I don't know the acronyms, guys, just stick it into Google, MDOT.
It's Google AppV, we don't even have to say anything about it.
Now, you can use AppV as part of a VDI solution, okay? So
it must be the Microsoft Desktop Optimization Platform, isn't it? That sounds about right.
Yeah, there's actually a VDI license for AppV, so if you wanted to stream your applications into a VDI, and if you don't know what VDI, we'll touch on that in a second, there's another license for it. If you want to use AppV over terminal services, it's actually included as part of the 2008 Terminal Services CAL. So lots of people aren't aware, and maybe certain people have been guilty of not realising that certain companies might actually be licensed for this now. Okay, so you might actually be able to use this now, but only by a terminal server. So what this means is, and this is another great way to keep your terminal servers nice and clean. You know, so I've got a single terminal server running, and I've got virtual applications running in on that terminal server, and you're running them on that terminal server in that virtual bubble, if you like.
So we could have virtualized servers running on virtualized storage, hosting terminal services, which is virtual desktop, which then deploys virtualized applications then.
Absolutely, yeah.
Wow.
Sounds like one for next episode, I think.
Yeah,
it's a bit ambitious.
It might be a multi-part of that one, unless someone wants to buy some decent servers.
And donate
that,
yes.
That would be good.
I can sort out the virtual hardware and the virtual storage to the virtual servers, and then you can sort out the...
All networked virtually as well, yeah, with virtual NICs, and yes, I think that'd be interesting. But, yeah, I mean,
so
that sounds interesting.
Yeah, AppV, I'd certainly see it as the future, and I wouldn't be surprised, you know, and I don't understand why, you know, applications aren't installed as AppV packages, or, you know, you don't buy Office as an AppV package already. You know, and the concept of writing to the local OS might disappear, who knows. Certainly seems to make sense. Anyway, so that's AppV. So I can talk about Microsoft AppV a little bit. Citrix have got an offering, Citrix Zen App, and MedV is something slightly different. So I'm not overly sure on VMware if they've got an application virtualization platform. Do you know, Mark?
I'm not sure. I mean, I've not seen anything.
I'm not overly sure. I know they've got a VDI one. I'm not sure on the application
side. I don't know
side.
If they've got an application one, I think. They need to check, but I think they've definitely got the desktop one that's been around a little while, but I've not seen anything on the application one.
Okay, so this is a solution for running applications on your machine in a virtual environment, but CFA came up with a question about if you're running multiple versions of Office. So we often hit this again, I'll say the NHS, you might be, or lots of organisations out there might still rely on IE6.
Yes.
Now, the problem with IE6 is, well, IE6 doesn't work on Windows Vista or Windows 7. Okay?
Thank God.
That counts as 7 for default, doesn't it? Okay, so yeah, so with IE6, if you're stuck on IE6,
it's the integration. Well, I have that a lot of trouble using lots of bits of SAN software that hook into Java, and we have an awful lot of problem when you start running IE7, IE8.
Yeah.
Hence why a lot of the management interfaces struggle on 2008 and R2, 2003, and often people have gone on there, downloaded automatic updates, and one of them is, you know, IE7 or IE8.
Yeah, so many people have done that,
And you find it breaks a lot of your management tools, and you really struggle to get them working if you're trying to uninstall it. So something like this, and if you can roll it out to servers as well, can you do it on a server out of curiosity?
Why not?
Put multiple, you can. So
yeah.
But then the user has to log on because it targets users.
It can target users, it can also target machines.
Right.
There's no problem. It's just an advantage because a lot of the time that's what we want to do is target users, and that wasn't available to us cleanly. Because what used to happen is you used to log on to my machine and you used to install bloody Photoshop on my machine.
Yeah.
Well, I don't want that.
I personally would like on my machine to have multiple web browsers from IE6, 7,
yeah.
8. So when I'm doing a lot of the sound management, I can use IE6. And when I'm doing other things, I can use IE8. I'm not sure why I'd need IE7, mind you.
Is it intelligent enough for you to tell it that if the user already has it installed locally, not to push out?
You would have to attach some logic to that, because maybe you want them to run that virtualized version of it.
Okay. Can you force the file association then?
This is something I haven't done, but you would be able to change the file association. You can do that via group policy preferences.
Right.
That would be one way. There might be a better way of doing it, but you would certainly be able to do it that way.
Okay.
Okay, so we were talking about IE6, and the problem with IE6 is that simply won't run on Windows 7. So what you do have, and the slide's showing MedV, I will come up to in a second, is something called Windows XP mode. So when you're running Windows 7, I don't know if any of you have downloaded it, Actually, you might not be able to because you need a particular version of Windows 7, don't you? I think you need professional and above to do this.
Yeah.
But Windows 7 allows you to run, and this is something I should have demoed actually, might be able to. It allows you to run a virtual XP machine. Okay, now in this virtual XP machine, we can run IE6 or you can run any XP application. So let's see how far I can get on this demo. I wasn't planning on doing this, but with a little bit of thought, I might have been able to pull it off.
With a little bit of luck.
If I go down and have a look at my machines, I've got
everyone will be able to know what apps you have now.
I've got nothing dodgy there, apart from Grabbit maybe. I've got a virtual PC down there and I've got XP mode. So if I fire XP mode, it would just fires up my virtual machine. If I go into XP applications, you can see these are all the applications I've got available.
So what are the requirements for XP mode then? Because I tried to launch XP mode and it said my hardware wasn't supported or something like that.
Let's see. It's very similar to the requirements of Hyper-V. You know, you need to, I forget the actual name of it, but your BIOS actually needs to support hardware-assisted virtualization, whatever flavour that might be, AMD or Intel.
And often, what most people forget when they see that message, and yours might be the case, is typically you go into the BIOS and turn it on.
Yeah.
Normally by default it's switched off.
Because I've got the same laptop as you.
Yeah. It's normally turned off by default.
Okay.
I'm not sure why, but
Did you have to do that?
Don't think so.
Right.
I'm not sure.
Typically on servers it would be, so Hyper-V tends not to work by default. VMware kind of works but moans, and you get lots of warning and error messages coming up, and it's basically you've not enabled the virtualization technology at the hardware level.
So this is its own virtual machine within your...
Yeah, so this is Windows 7, and I'm running Windows XP in that. Now, a lot of you have probably done this with virtual PC or VMware, nothing special on this, and from a user point of view, this isn't very nice. You know, if they want to run IE6, I don't want them to launch XP mode. But what you can do is... any application that you put in the all program files, so basically any application you were to install automatically gets, I'm not sure if this is the right word, but elevated as such to the Windows 7 or escalated to the Windows 7 start menu. So if I install Adobe Photoshop in here, it will, you'll see it in the Windows 7 start menu. Now I think what you can do is you can do a little bit of playing around. Where's the Internet Explorer shortcut?
So you can actually open it from within Windows 7.
Yes.
But it's actually seamlessly running XP mode, so to speak.
Yes. Correct. Right, can someone help me out with IE? Know where IE is?
Can you click on start and drag and drop it off the...
I don't think that's a shortcut, that's the trouble.
Is that not a shortcut?
No, I don't think so. But I'll let you off on this one. I just thought... No, it's been a while since I've given it any glory. Right, I think that's all you need to. If you were to install an application, this will work automatically, but I believe if you drag it into the All Users Start menu, now it might need to be in program, so you know, I'll copy it into there as well. I'll copy it bloody everywhere, try and get this thing working. And now let's just minimise this.
Demo on the fly.
Is that the screen? Yeah, so that can go away. My machine's just slowed down a little bit. And now if I go into all programs and go to my virtual PC and go into XP mode applications, what you'll see is Internet Explorer XP mode. So I can just click on that. Because I've got it open already, I'm just going to ignore all of those and I'm going to restart later on that.
That's a warning, you've already got the XP open in the background anyway.
Yeah. So, of course, the user wouldn't see all of this. It's because I opened up the XP mode just a minute ago. But all the user gets to see is the IE6 opening, which we'll see in a second. So, we can see that. Yeah, a lot of our users are still Mac users. You know, we get about 40% from iTunes Mac. So, if you're a Mac user, this is similar to what VMware do or on the Mac in VMware Fusion. Oh, you git.
Nothing like a live demo.
Yeah. Well, it's probably because of that.
I think
it's because of the updates.
I think it's waiting for you to restart.
So. I think so. I'm going to say restart later on that one. And I'm going to try just once more, because I really do want to show you this. Have I got anything else that might... Forefront, Appin Tools, what have we got in there? That's not exciting, is it? Is there a Forefront? Let's have a this one. There you go. Okay, so here's a Windows XP application
even the,
running.
Interface is XP5.
Yeah, so this is my forefront client security working in XP. You can see it from the sort of XP style interface. It's such a shame that the I shortcut doesn't work. But
try it again.
You would get the idea.
I get the idea, yeah. That's good. So this is kind of application virtualization, but running it within a...
Yeah, this is application virtualization.
DIY.
It's sort of OS virtualization, isn't it?
Yeah.
But it's used to support an application.
Yeah, it's kind of, yeah.
Right, so yeah, we can see a few problems with this. So the problems you've got with this is if you are going to roll this out to all your client machines, and we all want to run 86, then effectively, just like I'm having to do here, I'm supporting two OSs.
Yes.
Okay, so this OS, my XP machine, you can see, wants a restart now.
So you have to restart that your whole host machine?
No, you can just do a restart now on this.
But this brings on what I've just seen there, patch management. You've got to patch two OSs.
Absolutely,
all the updates, service packs, hot fixes, have got to be done to both your Windows 7 and... the XP mode, and I see you already had another copy of antivirus on there, so it is completely
like
another machine. So it is it's a virtual desktop.
Really. It's a virtual desktop, yeah. And that's a good point. You saw I had forefront antivirus in there, which is really important to have in there, because otherwise my XP machine could get a virus, and I wouldn't really care too much on that one. So let's think about this for real. In an organisation, if I want everyone to run a particular application, it's only works on Windows 7. What do I actually have to do? Yeah, go for it. What do I need to do? Well, you need to have XP mode on all your Windows 7 machines, and you also need to have the XP operating system rolled out. Now, you might want to do a little bit of branding to that. So I might want to put some company branding on that, and also I want to give you Adobe and IE6. That's my main job. So Medvii is a solution which enables an administrator to create this centralized virtual desktop. So I can, using Medvii, I can create this virtualized desktop, very similar to creating a standardized image. I can put Adobe in there, I can add all my utilities, put Forefront in there, and I can use Medvii to roll that out onto all my client machines. So I've got a centralized way of managing all the XP machines. In theory,
so
if you
this,
wanted
so
to.
So this manages all those XP machines that you just showed us. This
absolutely.
Is just a way of managing all of those.
To push them out.
So
them
you
all
use
the same.
AppVii?
No.
To
not all the same,
no. Once it's out there, I think that's where it leaves it, relinquished control. But Medvii, the version that we'll do this is version 2, which is not out as yet. So I don't really know the full ins and out of this product. But that's the idea. It gives us some centralized management of it. So otherwise, it's going to be a nightmare. Questions?
No.
Cool.
No, I just think this is... for the next episode, we'll demo all of this like we did with the sounds.
Yeah, AppVii is definitely worth going into. Medvii would be nice to look into when we get a release on that. That'd be really good. But terminal servers, that also fits into things. That's virtualization as well. So lots of people didn't see terminal servers as virtualization, but if you stop and think about it, it clearly is.
They've renamed that now, rebranding. What they called it?
It hasn't got a V on the end of it, which is strange. It's RDS, Remote Desktop Services. Okay, so that's what it's called now. What we're going to call it is presentation virtualization, because if you think about it, that's what it's doing, is it's virtualizing, that's a great new word, virtualizing the presentation layer. So, nothing really too much about terminal services, but we've got a few additional features we could use for application compatibility. We could use something called Remote App. So, on my terminal server, what I could do is... I can install, let's say, the new version of Office 2010, and I can publish that as a remote application through terminal services, and you guys can run that. Now, when you run that up, and this is something I have shown you in a previous episode, but we go back and we do...
Is this like published apps?
It's published apps,
published
apps. Yeah. It's what Citrix has been doing for absolutely ages, and
yes.
Microsoft is playing catch-up
yes.
on this side of things. So Suface sees the link, she clicks on it. In the background, it's firing up a TS session to it.
Yes.
But the user doesn't get to see any of that because that's too complex.
Yeah.
We don't want to log on twice.
It's taken a bit like what you've just shown us with XP on the desktop to Windows 7, but he's doing it at the kind of server
absolutely,
level.
Yeah.
And it's been doing it for a number of years, hasn't
yes.
it? So it's a lot slicker, so you don't actually see the delay and all the rest of it. It is seamless. Really,
yeah,
it? So.
It's really a nice solution. And you can tie all these up, and this is when it really gets messed up. So with presentation virtualization, this remote app we're publishing, it could be a virtualized app.
Yes.
You know, it could be AppVii. And remember, you're covered for that license if you're Windows 2008.
I've actually seen this used a lot actually over the last few years actually, where people are starting to use terminal servers in large farms for lots of users, or even Citrix as well actually in the previous versions. Is it presentation server? Is it the version, the previous one?
Yep, who knows?
It's before the Zen. But basically what people are doing before all of this App V that you're talking about now is they're always having these issues with conflicts of applications, especially when you're starting to talk about back-end server applications. It was a nightmare. And if you've got some large organisations, say 1,000 concurrent users running on terminal servers or Citrix, then actually you wouldn't want to deploy every single app to every single server because it would just become unstable
yeah.
very quickly. So what I found a lot of people have been doing is they have a front-end terminal server farm where they have all the default kind of applications, that all the Office and all those
yeah.
kind of things, which are kind of branded as safe apps that they know work together. And in all of the bespoke applications, they have a different set of terminal servers, two or three, that would just have those apps installed on them and nothing else.
Yeah, makes
and
sense.
Then they would publish the app to the front-end terminal servers. So all of the users connect to the front-end servers, and then every time they click on an app that's not a local known app, it actually launches the app from another terminal server.
That's a published app into that TS.
Yeah.
That's
and
mental.
And what
but is it in a bubble?
It could be.
Well, it could be, but as far as the user's concerned, they just see the icons, they click on it and it's running, but it's running actually on another terminal server, which could be
yeah.
virtual or not. And in fact, one of the ones I've been working on, actually, they've got every single terminal server is actually a virtual server. They've got no real physical servers, and they have 1,000 concurrent users. And the other advantage of doing that, really, is we've been talking a bit more, actually, here, is application maintenance. Is
yeah.
when a new version of the app comes out, or a service pack or a patch, if you've got that installed on every server, then that's an awful lot of updates. If you've only got that app running on three or four servers, then you can actually take those servers out. You can just tell everybody that that application is not available, so if you click on it, it doesn't work. But the rest of the servers are still working fine.
Yeah.
The rest of the apps are still working fine. You can do maintenance on the app, finish it, turn them on and republish them, and users carry on working.
Yeah,
and that has worked very
yeah,
well.
I can see that.
Very well.
I'm just trying to think, trying to find a way to make that even more useful. And I'm thinking App V. App V's got to fit
yes.
in there, isn't it? So if you were to get that updated application, repack it
yes.
or resequence it, then you've done it once. That will restream to the back end TSs,
yes.
which gets published to the front
yes.
TSs.
Oh, because I've actually seen that working.
Yeah.
And it works very well. So now with all these new products coming along, you can actually integrate even more.
Yeah.
So it'd be even more streamlined and slicker.
So that's looking at terminal services, presentation, virtualization. I think, again, some of the other benefits are obvious, but just to run through it, the nice thing about terminal services, or sorry, remote desktop services, is when the user's working on these, the data's left within the organization. Okay, so they're not running around with a laptop with important confidential files. They're working across the network in a secured environment. Everything's nice and protected. So secure data and applications, and accelerate application deployment, obviously. Well, Mark's just said, you know, once we're at Office 2010, do I want to roll it out to 2,000 machines or one
Definitely.
TS or three TSs?
I mean, I remember years ago that it was really Citrix that led the way, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It was a big take-up on Citrix. Then it kind of dropped off a little, and the reason I think it dropped off was price. Citrix became very, very expensive, and I think it's only in probably the last 6 months or a year or so that they've actually started bringing the price down to
yeah.
a more realistic level, because I think it's always been a fantastic product, but they were killing themselves on the price. Just people couldn't justify the massive cost
yeah.
per user, because I think if you had all the features,
might as well buy a PC for each.
Well, it was getting that way. I think if you had every single feature that Citrix had to offer, you were talking probably £150-£200 or something like that a user. Plus, you always had to buy the Microsoft licenses as well. These were like add-ons to what you already
yeah.
had to buy to start with. So it was very expensive.
Now, I remember when Citrix OS came out, because I was working as a trainer at that point, and there was all this buzzword, and everyone thought, yeah, this is the next
yeah.
big thing, and everyone's going to. And there's all the, you know, old chaps saying, oh, this back to mainframe days and all this nonsense. And I sort of prepared for it, and it never really happened.
It was a little bit of a spike, and it dropped
yeah.
off. But I've seen a remarkable take-up on it.
I've seen it now.
Lately,
yeah.
last year, definitely 6 months. A lot of it is for, like you just said, keeping data locally. is a fantastic solution for remote access.
Yeah.
I mean, the very tactical point solutions are virtually everywhere I go now. People have got some kind of remote desktop terminal server for remote access.
Yeah.
We use it all the time. It's very tactical, very good, and works well. And it's making a big comeback. And I think hence why we spoke about before, Microsoft kind of backing Citrix.
Yeah, they're sticking together, aren't they?
I think they're realizing it's coming back again.
I was thinking why it didn't happen is, it's almost like what happened back then to Citrix is what's happening now with VDI. It was the buzzword. And I think often people pick up the buzzword and they just run with it and they suddenly realise, oh, maybe this isn't for me.
Yeah.
And maybe bandwidth was an issue back then.
I think bandwidth, definitely, cost of bandwidth, and also server processing power.
Yeah.
Because it did work, but there was only so many users. They kept saying you could get 20, 25 users per server. And I remember back in the version 4s and version 3s of the Citrix application, but people always struggled to get 20-25, and servers were quite expensive then.
Yeah.
And then you had to buy another one. But now, with the sheer processing power of servers and virtualization, is also, I think, seeing them take off, where you can put multiple terminal servers on a physical box.
Yeah.
Within an virtualized environment, so whether that's Zen server, VMware, or Hyper-V, you put in all your terminal servers inside that. All of a sudden, it scales and works. So, yes.
How does the ICA client work then? Because that's browser-based, isn't it?
It's just different ways of connecting to servers. Originally, there was a client, and it used a protocol to connect to the back-end servers. And all they've done over the years is they've had different types of clients and different protocols to give you different and more flexible ways of connecting to the server. So some people only allow, say, web browser traffic in to their organisation. So
right.
If you can actually encapsulate all of the terminal server session within a web browser, that gives you
Well, because I've seen some, the browser version where there's actually links to applications, where people click on and it actually launches the application. So that's a virtualized application, is it? Or does the client have to be installed onto the
That would probably be a remote app. Very probably a remote app where I'm running. And what you're describing, Microsoft can do that out of the box. You don't have to pay anything for that. So, and again, the Microsoft TS does work over the web as well.
They've done, the web was often brought out for if you're travelling around and you haven't got your own desktop with your laptop.
Yeah.
It's more laptop than desktop. So you haven't got all the software, but you might want to go into an internet cafe or somewhere else or borrow someone else's machine, and you want to actually get access to your remote desktop. Typically, you'd always find a web browser somewhere. So if you can make it work over a web browser, you can quickly get access to that critical app or something that you need without having to carry around your own device.
Cool. So here's a little graphical presentation. Virtualization, probably get the point on this. So on the left-hand side, we can see all the little, all of them, three of us. So we're running an application. We're interfacing with a terminal server in the middle, and even if we're running an application on each one of those, it's important to realise the applications are running on the server on the right-hand side. Okay, so if that goes down, it brings down all the applications that are, that those users are running. So that's something to think about. Think about when you're designing your Citrix or your TS or your RDS environment, make sure you've got some high availability built into that, or some, I think Citrix call them farms, don't they?
Mm-hmm.
Citrix farms, high availability on that one. So that's just looking at presentation virtualization. I'm sure there's loads of other stuff to add. What have I read recently about 2008? Yeah, the issue you got in 2008 R2 at the moment, the biggest blocker that people are having is the fact it's 64-bit only now. And that's leading to lots of problems with applications which aren't working in 64-bit, which
one
makes...
One of the biggest things I've come across actually is applications are still behind the curve when it comes to 64-bit. They are taking, even Office, it's only Office 2010, isn't it, when it eventually comes out in a few weeks' time or a couple of months. It's going to be 64-bit, but applications are still struggling. And although majority work on a 64-bit platform, there are still issues, isn't there? So
yeah, and it's just those legacy ones. It's and unfortunately, it's exactly the kind of applications that you want to be running on a TS. No, it's those ones. Hey, so that's just a little update on remote desktop services, what Microsoft have been doing with it. I won't spend too much time on it. It's just really looking at 2008 updates. So we've got remote app and remote desktop connections. The remote app one is the one which gives them the ability to access the application without the hassle of logging onto a second desktop, etc. So it's very, very easy for the user. We do support multi-monitors now, so I can go into my, or use remote desktop services to go into my Windows 7 machine at home, and if I dual monitors, I will see that. We've got support for AeroGlass, so very, very useful. Significantly improve your productivity with that one. And remote app language
right
support, which is something I just read out and don't really know much about, but sort of know from reading it.
When you want to translate it all to Chinese. which none of us read or speak.
Right, so Citrix Zen App. Citrix Zen App, I'm going to go a little bit quiet on this one.
Well, Zen App, we've spoken quite a bit about this. That was the version of, I said, 3.5. I was trying to remember the name of it that you've got it up there, actually. It was WinFrame.
Okay,
That was the first version I actually used.
It's WinFrame and MetaFrame, didn't you?
Yeah, it was WinFrame, from my memory serves me correctly, was on NT351. And then when it went to NT4, it went to MetaFrame. And then over the period of time, it then went to Presentation Server. And now Presentation Server is now Zen App. So they're all the previous names of pretty much the same product as it's evolved over the years. And as it's evolved, it's got more and more features, more and more efficient. They've always basically kind of that one or two steps ahead of Microsoft, aren't they?
So, yeah.
And there was always rumour in the early days that Microsoft licensed some of the early features of Terminal Server from Citrix. I don't know how true that was.
I heard that too.
I'd heard it. It may well be true. But it's kind of got a lot of the features from Citrix to start with. And as Citrix, it's almost like Citrix developed a new feature. I know they've got new protocols out there.
Yeah.
Like HDX protocols for doing lots of streaming and videos and all those kind of wonderful things. I mean, they've got some fantastic technology. They're always one or two steps ahead of everybody else. It's almost like as they develop something new, then they chuck out off the bottom, Microsoft, you can have that kind
yeah.
of thing. So, hence why probably Microsoft are backing them, as we've been saying all along now, just because they keep getting some of the older the older features.
I think the one thing I didn't know about Citrix, I've never implemented a Citrix server, to be honest. I've seen them everything, but. Yeah, it sits on top of a full terminal server. And one thing I didn't realise is you actually have to pay for both licences.
Yeah.
So you're paying for the Microsoft licence plus the Citrix.
Most people forget. And that was, as we touched on a little while ago, that was one of the killers. The terminal server, you had to buy a full terminal server licence, client access licences for Microsoft. And then on top of this, you were buying the Citrix licences, which basically, as you said there, gives better functionality, more efficient, and certainly in the early days, the protocol it used was far more efficient over low bandwidth than bad connections. It worked very well, where the terminal server one was a bit clunky, to say the least. But
yeah, so on the bottom there, it just says it's a protocol out of date. I remember some of you guys probably heard of it, it's ICA, wasn't it?
Yes.
There's the Citrix one, and Microsoft is RDP and has been for a while. But there was a new one, I don't know if you can remember that, the new Citrix one, the NTX or...
HDX, I think. That's the new protocol
that's
just been released.
And that's meant to be good for streaming media and stuff, isn't it?
I've seen that demo, actually. It's probably one online somewhere, but certainly I've seen the new desktop demo, which they stream a film over a broadband connection.
Okay.
I've actually seen it done live in a hotel. Very impressive, and does work.
Wow.
Yeah, so it's some good stuff there.
Cool. So that's a bit on Zen Apps. Users can access the full desktop, reliable and robust. I'm going to skip over that one, to be honest. I think we've pretty much covered on Citrix. Now, it says Citrix issues, and in brackets, TS. So this affects terminal services, or as we now know it, remote desktop services as well. And it's just a few things to think about. Users are sharing the same instance of the operating system. So if you've got one terminal server and we're all running Office on it, in effect, if your Office crashes, it could, in effect, bring my Office down, couldn't it? Because they're running, if you look at the new versions of Office, they're sharing processes, I believe. Perhaps I shouldn't be saying this, because I'm not sure if it's true, but logically I would suspect that might happen.
If you've got a problem on your server, is what we're saying here, though, if something goes wrong with your server, something goes slow, it affects everybody.
Yeah.
So it's not just going to affect one person. Something goes wrong and you've got 20 people on there, 20 people will be affected.
Yeah.
That's always been the case, and that's why you tend to have to be a bit careful, and some of the stuff that you've been talking about before, conflict analysis, making sure you're careful what you install. This was always where there was problems in days gone by.
Yeah.
What do I install on there? And I think that was the other reason it probably didn't take off. It was just so much work to making sure that there was no conflict and nothing crashed or broke down anything else, because it took the whole thing out. It's all your eggs in one basket, and the basket broke, you've lost everything. Okay, but with what you're just telling us now, though, you can see why all of a sudden this can start to take off again now.
And you
take that away.
And the thing that I'm shocked that I've learnt recently is I didn't realise that you're actually licensed to use this with your RDS licence. So you can use AppV with this. Right, Mark, this is the big one, eh? VDI, Virtual Desktop Infrastructure. Everyone's talking about it, and really it's the concept, you've done with servers, you virtualize your servers, why not virtualize your desktops? So very, very quickly, instead of having 100 machines, sitting on the desk, all burning up loads and loads of power, a complete nightmare to support, etc., why not put them all in the server room, run them in a virtual environment, and we can give people maybe something as simple as RDP access to that. What about doing something like that? So that's the concept of VDI.
They still need power to run the machine that's going to RDP into that.
Absolutely, yeah. So really with VDI, the idea of it is just the same as it's with servers, but you're doing it with workstations. Lots of people, on the next one, let's have a look at the benefits. The benefits of VDI, and this first benefit is the usable experience of desktop OS, not a server OS. And what we're talking about here is instead of the user running their application from a terminal server, they can actually RDP into a real workstation or connect up to that workstation on whatever means they want to, and they can run the application. So
this is much better for compatibility than there's still some applications that detect it's not a desktop operating system and do struggle to run properly. That has always been a little bit of a case with bespoke apps and all the rest of it. This is what people have been waiting for, really, hasn't it? But
Yeah, so the nice thing about this one is that the second point down is, again, users have got their own little environment, so they're much, much happier. They can work in their own little environment. It's not a shared OS at all, so if any application crashes, it crashes that one application. I suppose if that OS runs wild on that virtualized platform, it could have an impact.
It could. It could. I think they're quite good at that now, but that was another issue, that you're running lots of things on there, so multiple OSs, and one OS says, I'm going to grab as much of the CPU as I can.
Yeah.
You can restrict memory and all the rest of it. And a lot of these new systems now have limits. You can say how much a virtual machine can grab of the processor.
But
in theory, if you say, well, I'm going to grab 100% and use it all, you'll find that everybody else that's on that host will start to run slowly. So
that's the idea of VDI. And we're finding loads of people asking about VDI. And the most common thing I come across is lots of people say it's cost saving. I don't know what you feel, so lots of people saying it's cost saving. Rather than powering up all those machines on the desk, we can just put it all in the server room.
You've still got to have machines on the desk.
Exactly.
You've still got to connect to it. So you can have cheaper devices. I think this will start to take off as more and more people start to come up with desktop refresh policies. But until they're due to replace desktops, then they'll start to look at, should I put a new PC on the desk? Should I just put a thin client on the desk? Should I start to deploy VDI? But why, if they've got fairly new machines? I mean, now with Windows 7 just coming out, and a lot of people have been hanging on for a number of years with their XP machines because no one's going to touch Vista. I can see people starting to look at this, and it's probably why you and I keep hearing about this an awful lot. The other thing that's always, I think, struggled with this is in the past, the amount of storage that you've needed.
Yeah.
Because every single one of these has needed an install of an operating system. And if that's 10 gig, for argument's sake, a desktop, and you've got 100 desktops, it's 100 times 10 gig.
So you need your NetApp, isn't it?
And all of a sudden, that's an awful lot of storage that you need. Storage, actually, on SANs for that amount of storage and all the rest of it. There's a cost to that and all the rest of it, and providing all the infrastructure. And then you start adding all of that up, you start saying, how much of a saving is there?
Yeah.
And there may well be in other ways, but it starts to get a bit complicated. All of a sudden people just say, well, I think I'll just buy some more desktops for a few £100 each and look at it again next time.
Absolutely. I think there's certain places where VDI obviously fits. The last point, remote working. It's good for that. A user who roams around the place, they want access to a real desktop. So, from now I could RDP, or I could go into my desktop at work and I can work as I am, or I could go at home, or when I'm at work I can get a more rich experience because I've got better bandwidth maybe. So it's good for remote working.
And I think, we mentioned, deduplication of products like NetApps. The more deduplication that can exist, whether that's done at the hardware or the software layer, mm-hmm. I think the new VMware one can do its own kind of dedupe. It does the link clones like you were mentioning before.
Yeah.
The VMware workstation that's had it for quite a few years now, I think that technology has now been taken into the server product. So they do these kind of linked clones where you have the template and then just the differences. So that's how they save their space, where before, because there was no space saving, it was just hard work. The only one that really done it up to now, or up to a little while ago, was the Parallels one that you talked about originally,
yeah.
Because of its architecture. You know, all one desktop, that's what they were excelled at. VMware, I think, can do it with a new product. And obviously now you've got hardware manufacturers such as NetApp and the rest of it doing disk deduplication,
yeah.
On the disk. Therefore, once that takes off, you're going to find that actually you're not actually too worried about the amount of storage, because you know it's going to be optimized underneath. And so all of these things coming along now, you can see why people are starting to talk about this again more seriously and probably will start to take off.
Yeah. Yeah, with VDI, the other thing, that just tying back into Hyper-V, I think that's another reason why they rushed out this dynamic memory, you know, because otherwise how many VMs or how many,
yes.
Windows 7 machines will be able to
yes.
support?
You've got everything else which is dynamic or thin provisioned,
yeah.
And all the rest of it except the RAM.
Exactly.
And it's missing, isn't it?
And I think lots of people sort of jump into VDI and they do see it as the ultimate solution, and it's important not to rule out the other things like terminal services or Citrix. So if you go back, and I'll go back to this slide, VDI benefits for UC Faye when you're editing, it says tactical solution for remote working, and the scenario I said was I can go now and I can RDP into my, you know, VDI session, or you know, I could do it from anywhere. Well, couldn't I do that with the TS? Very probably you could. You know, but the advantages, of course, is the you know, I don't have my own session, maybe applications might not work on a server, but you can get very, very close to almost like a VDI session with terminal services.
You can, but the thing I've always found, typically, you're always a user on a terminal server.
Yeah.
And you have got what you're given, and it's rare you're able to change anything, because you'd normally only administrator can do that. Whereas
absolutely.
You've got a VDI, you can actually say, all right, you've got group policy and all the rest of it, but you can be a lot more flexible and say, well, that's your desktop. If you want to change the background, if you want to install this, if you want to modify that, you can. Obviously, group policies, you can control how
yeah.
much, but if you wanted to, you could say, do what you like, install what you like. Well, you would never dream of doing that on a terminal server. It just would be a disaster.
Yeah.
So how is it potentially expensive then? Licensing?
Well, there's the licensing. There's licensing issues, and also the fact that you know you're buying your hardware. You do need hardware on your on the desktop as well. So
it's becoming more cost effective. But originally, you're taking away with your desktops, which is fine. The desktops are quite cheap now, and you would need a back end server architecture for this. And if you're going to put a lot of people, you're going to need multiple servers. You're going to probably need clustering. You're probably
mm-hmm.
going to need shared storage, and you need to cater for all of that. More networking, so you need to, you know, you're not just doing away with your desktop, you're actually moving all of that and putting it in the server, which has other advantages, but you know, it could potentially be more expensive than you first thought, and you still need something, as we touched on a second ago, to actually connect back. You can't take it away and say, well, I've got nothing. So.
Yeah, this is only what, when they start building like RDP clients into TVs and stuff, and it's going to happen. You're going to see RDP client, not in the iPad, maybe. Yeah, it could well happen.
I just didn't expect it to be. I always just assumed that virtualization. I almost said the same word you said, but virtualizing anything would just primary reason would be to save on costs. But it looks like the main benefit for this is to actually streamline the way everybody.
I think
works.
Every different scenario is going to have different advantages. I think every customer is looking for something slightly different. So you really just saying what problem are you trying to solve, and then just go. Just
yeah.
trying to tap that, but yeah, it might not be expensive, you know, for certain companies, but for other ones, yeah, it might be hella expensive. Also, think about user experience as well. You know, there's no way that
yeah.
you know VDI is going to be a sub. It can get pretty close, but I've worked on terminal services. I'm not happy with them, you know. But a lot of us and lots of technical people are a bit fussier than the normal users, aren't they? You want some nice updates and everything. So that's VDI. Now, virtual desktop. Let's have a look at. Well, let's just mention VMware View is a VMware
that
solution
is the new version, yes.
for
yes.
VDI, and it's basically running on ESX. And the next stuff is looking at Microsoft's VDI solution, and it raises a few questions, because I just want to say again, what actually is VDI? What is virtual desktop infrastructure? Is it a way of providing a user a desktop, virtual desktop infrastructure, providing them a desktop, or is it giving them a RDP access to their own desktop machine, which is installed on a virtualized environment? Because Microsoft would actually argue this, and in TechNet, this message was very, very clear. A VDI solution might be RDS. Okay, it might be remote desktop services. A VDI solution is not necessarily what I, the way I've described it in the upcoming slides.
So they're basically saying it could be either. They're basically saying you're connecting to a remote desktop. That desktop could be server-based desktop, which is RDS, or it could be a workstation-based desktop, which is remote desktop. Was that what they're calling it, remote desktop?
Remote desktop.
Or VDIs?
So have you watched those ads on telly where this person's at the meeting and then the birds bring in their his computer because he's forgotten a file? But basically, I think it's PC Anywhere or something. Is that a VDI sort of thing as well? Because that's actually logging on to...
Go my piece, that's just...
particular machine.
Like remote control, isn't it? It's just like, log me in.
Yeah, it's kind of like that.
You're remote controlling a device. That could be a physical device. You could be a VDI, actually. You could have a VDI.
It could be, couldn't it?
Rather than connecting to it with a VDI client, you could connect to it with something like that. So...
Okay.
So it's saying that, yeah. So, yeah, not stupid at first thought. I'm not you, the question. Right, so you can see in this example down the bottom, what we do have is we've got a Hyper-V server running some terminal services, I'm going to call them, and we've also got Hyper-V, which could potentially be running multiple copies of Windows 7. And what you have is you have a connection broker, a remote desktop connection broker. Users connect up to that, and they're directed to either session depending on what they're trying to do. Okay, so it's all logic which you control.
Is that the kind of bit like the TS gateway?
Yeah.
Is this a kind of newer version of TS Gateway?
Yeah, but what it's meant to do is broker between, and I'm a bit shaky on this, as you probably detect, it sort of brokers between whether the user requires a full VDI client or whether a remote desktop session will sort of satisfy them. And this is the one message which was, as I said, been sort of shouted about, and why don't I know that much about it then, you could argue. But this is one of the things saying, oh yeah, the connection broker, you might want to investigate Citrix's connection broker. That was the message we were getting all the time. And they were actually saying, ours doesn't scale that well. You might want to look at Citrix. It's almost like they're preventing people from using Microsoft and failing and saying this is rubbish. So again, tying up with Citrix to try and attack Microsoft. Okay, so just got a few case studies on here. I think I've taken out all the names on this one, so that's okay to use, Marco.
I think so.
Yeah. So in this fictitious case study, we've got 300 remote access users. They've got an array of servers with no fault tolerance, HA, disaster recovery. Downtime is required for maintenance. And what they did is virtualized it, replicate servers, and take over from email.
Yeah. I mean, what they're looking at, we're giving an example here. As someone, you know, has an awful lot of servers, no fault tolerance. And they're looking for a way of consolidating or virtualizing what they've got to reduce the amount of hardware that they've got, and to give them a kind of high availability locally, and also disaster recovery in the event of a site failure. So what you can see here is this particular organization, well, luckily they're multiple sites, so they can actually implement virtualization across their sites. And using the technology, they can actually allow people to remotely connect to different sites, and they can replicate all of this information around to give them a very resilient, high available, fault tolerant system here, rather than having banks and banks of servers.
So those 12 Citrix servers on each site, do they host the same servers and that?
Yes, you can do. They could be a
So they're all replicated across.
Yeah. There's various ways of doing all of these, and once you start going into these, you need to go into a bit more detail. So you could have banks of servers at each one and install them all separately, or you can have all your servers built in a virtual environment. I think this particular one is that they built all of their desktop servers or application servers all on Citrix and Zen server, and then because it's all virtualized, it's all file-based underneath. All of that was replicated to another environment. So whenever they made a change to site A, it was automatically, by the underlying technology, replicated to site B. So otherwise you'd have to install an app on site A, go to site B and install an app, and then go to site C and install an app, where if you can actually say, well, I'm going to install it on one, and because it's all virtualized, you can replicate that virtualized environment to another site.
Is there a general rule of thumb, say, for how many users you can have per server, so to calculate how many servers you, or is that dependent on what you're
running? We found if you're using remote desktop services or things like Citrix, ZenApp, typically a good rule of thumb is around 25 users per server instance, which is normally a virtual server instance. We have seen people up to 50.
Because you mentioned, was it this episode or maybe the previous one, that, no, I think it's this episode, that you were at a customer who had like 2,000 concurrent users,
yes,
or something. How large was this farm?
The farm was about 40 servers in the end, but they did have tiers. So what they found there was actually very similar to this, what we're looking at here, is they used to have basically one new servers, and they had probably two or three racks full of them in their server room, just stacked up one after the other for, and it runs about 20 odd users per box. Work that out by 1,000 users, that's 50, is it? 50 servers? About 50,
yeah,
servers. So they're about 50 odd physical servers, so
right,
imagine all that being powered. They then virtualized that, so they actually used VMware, but another one we've done did it on Zen as well. It doesn't really matter, they're both very, very similar. And they took all of those 50 servers and they virtualized them into 50 virtual servers.
Okay.
Yeah. So they did that. So that shrunk them down. They actually got those 50 virtual servers onto, I think this particular one I'm thinking of was about 8 physical servers in one site.
That's quite significant.
So they've gone down from 50 physical servers just to 8. They then put in a back-end storage, and it is all, the one I'm thinking of is almost identical to this one. This one's there, used particularly Echologic, and another one that I've done was on HP. But it doesn't matter, they all do this kind of thing. So this is very similar. I've done quite a few. This one here, you can see, it's basically got a virtual environment, and then they're replicating it around the three sites. It works very well, and you can see they've got site A there, has got a bank of servers, shared storage, all of their terminal services, remote desktop services are on one system. That system is replicated using hardware, so all of the virtual servers are on virtual disks, which we talked about right at the beginning.
I was just going to ask what technology actually controls them, because you could have users writing to disk on like all three sites.
Yes.
What's the technology that synchronizes all of them to make sure they're all the same version? Is it SAN level?
On this particular one, it's SAN level. So basically the underlying disk storage system would be controlling the replication there. So typically there you'd have a number of users that would be connecting to site A, and on everything they do is being replicated to a bank of servers at site B. You also have another set of users that may be already working from site B, so each of those offices, you know, could have several hundred users at each one, but each one is also becoming a disaster recovery site for its neighbour. So that's what in this instance what was happening here. So you could say there was 200 people using the servers at site A and 200 at B, 200 at C, but if site A went, there was a complete copy of A on B, so actually you could get 400 people,
yep,
all on it. And this is it's unusual to have a solution
like
this.
I just find it amazing that you can actually merge, you know,
two
sites like that.
Typically, the most common ones I come across is two sites.
Yeah, because
now
you've brought that up, I'm working that in my head, and I'm thinking SQL replication and merge replication.
Yeah,
and how that's...
It's quite amazing, because usually you just push it one way and then you fail over or something, but then
this
seems a bit...
The only time I've been involved in these kind of organisations, you mentioned the NHS, this is quite popular on the NHS, because our NHS typically have multiple sites.
Yeah.
The other one is local council. There's probably lots of others that they, you know, finance all the rest of it, but you know, they're typically offices where they've got quite a concentrated people, and we tend to find that virtualization, remote desktop services and all those kind of things are, I think, are taking off in the public sector.
So what's the latest?
Well, it's the type of work, is it sort of maps very nicely to them, doesn't it?
It keeps all of their data.
Yeah.
No, because
off the trains.
There's so much bad publicity about hospitals and councils and local government, all the rest of it, keep losing data.
Mm.
That there's a lot of organisations putting in this kind of solution now to say, well, actually, our data isn't going to leave the building, and not only that, we've actually got a couple of copies of it, so if something went wrong with the building, we can carry on using
what
it.
What kind of latency do you require for this kind of thing to work?
This can be done with reasonable latency, actually. It doesn't need to be anything special on this.
Just confuses me even more.
Yeah, because if you're there and I'm here and we're writing to the same,
you won't be writing to the same disk. So you'll be writing to one disk, one will be writing to the other.
But we're using the same application
like SQL, but you're writing to a different table within the database. So when they merge, they're not.
For this one here, you could treat this one that we're looking at as like three separate farms or clusters. So if you relate to SQL, if you do a lot of SQL, imagine this is three SQL instances, and each instance is being replicated to another server. So there's only ever three instances, but instance one is at site one, instance two is at two, but if one goes, instant one will appear at site two. So you can never have the same instance active at both sides.
Yeah, that's what I'm asking. Like, you know, these are all active. These people in the second site, they're writing to the servers in the second site.
Yes.
So they're all active.
In this particular one, this is unusual. Normally you have an active, what we call active passive. For most of the users would be at site A.
That I can understand.
And if site B goes down, you can move.
Yeah,
to
that's
the
just
site.
Okay.
Yeah.
Anyway, we
spent
a long
time.
It's
quite
a
complex one for us to talk around. You probably started off with a smaller one.
Have we got a smaller one? Well, if I knew about that, I would have deleted it. we know the idea, and what I'm going to show you is really just wrap up and show you.
There's some nice pictures here of this is one I was actually involved in. This is a typical server room, and maybe people watching this would recognise that from a server room of lots of servers, and you know, you go around the back and there's lots of cables there, and that's
that's
reasonably well.
Yeah.
I've seen worse.
Yeah.
So that's an example. Lots of racks, lots of servers, and then you put in the virtualized. This one's got virtualized disks on a SAN. It's using virtualized servers, and then using virtualized operating systems. So we've kind of virtualized everything,
and there's your blade.
Everything there from the storage and all the servers are all in one rack.
Mm-hmm.
So we've taken, was that 5, 6, 7 racks? And
I feel like this is an ad for those vacuum sacks. You know, you have these duvets and pillows and suddenly it's
so uncanny you should see that and you said that. I don't know if anyone's seen the latest copy of The Office or latest.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh.
So this is giving everybody some examples of, you know, of actually space saving, cooling. And I think if you went on the previous slide, you go back, and I think from memory, if I just check, you know, it's the one before, there's actually a thermometer in one of these on the background on the wall. And if you look at the temperature, I think it was that one.
This one?
Oh, no, the one after that one.
Before?
Stop.
Before one?
Yeah, this
that
one, yeah.
One. You see,
where?
There was a...
point it out so I can circle it when I edit it.
There isn't a one before, it goes...
My screen takes a bit longer time.
Oh, okay, sorry. So we're in before one. I'll move on to before two.
Yeah.
Is it that white thing?
On the left-hand side.
Oh, your screen's buggered. Yeah, it's that white box, yes?
Yeah.
Oh,
if you look on
I'll circle that.
That's a thermometer. You can't really see it on this picture, but I know it's running quite high. So basically, because there was so much equipment in the room and the aircon couldn't cope, it was actually overheating.
Yeah.
But then when they finished and got it all down to this one rack, they actually didn't need to buy more air conditioning either. The air conditioning could actually cope because it wasn't so much.
So this is green. This is a green solution.
It's all green.
Love it.
All green, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Reduce, reuse, recycle.
After three.
That's not bad. All the cables are pink. I like that.
Anyway, so that was our introduction to virtualization. So I think in our two episodes, we did a reasonable job of going through.
Well, I've learned a lot anyway.
Yeah, hopefully. Storage virtualization, network virtualization, server virtualization, what else?
Application,
presentation, you name it, we've done it.
So I think what leaves us to do on the next ones really is to
demo
some of that.
Yeah, pick one of them and we'll start delving down on them.
Zen server.
Zen I would like to, but I've got to be realistic in terms of producing an episode.
Okay,
I think
App V
would probably be a good one to start.
We're doing App V for the next one, yeah.
But tell us what you think, and if you want us to go or explain any of these topics in further detail, drop us a line, but it doesn't work, does it? Yeah, go to itunes.com. We've got a form on there, and you can just write what you want, and we may read it and do an
episode.
Be
a contributor.
Good.
That's better.
Okay.
Better. Okay.
Until next time.
Until next time.
Right.
See ya.
Bye.
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 Bye.